I say shout out to all the brothers and sisters out there in social media land. This is indeed a great day to be alive. It's a day that the Most High has made. We should rejoice and be glad in it. Shouts out to all our brothers and sisters out there. This is going to be I know that this is probably going to be a subject that we're going to be on for a minute. There's just no possible way I'm going to be able to get these points across with one video. So we started the videos off and we did one. This is going to be part two. And we just going to simply title it, My Sheep Hear My Voice. Now, when we look at our personal life, like take for instance, I look at my personal life. Everybody have a desire in their heart to live a righteous life. Even people that don't seem like they have a desire, they have a desire deep down on the inside to live a righteous life. Now, what stops us? There be a number of things, but like in my personal case, you say to yourself, you look at your life and you say, man, this need to change right here. I need to fix this right here. Then you find yourself almost powerless to do those things, no matter how much you try. So in most cases, what we do is we either gravitate towards some organization or we gravitate to the Bible and we start learning things out of there with the hopes that, okay, this is going to help change my life. And once you've been walking so long, there are many of you out there that's reading the scripture right now and it's part of organizations right now. Still have some of the same hang-ups that you had before you even started. You was hoping that when I went in this direction, that somehow or another, me learning the scripture will cause this thing in my life to fall off. Me becoming a part of this organization will cause this thing in my life to change. You find out that it haven't changed. So what you really see is you see that those things don't have the power to change the life. They just don't. They just don't, and they never have. And so when we start talking about my sheep hear my voice, you are literally talking about the spirit, because the Messiah, he's not on the earth in flesh and blood in physical form now, where he can deal where he deal directly with men or give men the power to do things. So when we're going to hear his voice, we got to hear his voice through the Spirit. Now, we're going to show you some things that some messages, the points are so hard to get across because I don't know. I'm just going to stop right now. Most High, by your Spirit, may you grant me the grace to be able to express some of the things that's going through my mind that I really don't know how to get out. I need help. And so if the brothers and sisters are going to be edified on the day, then it's going to take you to do it. Now, I confess that if you don't do it, then it ain't going to get done, and I'm going to end up shutting the video off. So it's all praises to the Most High for that. Blessing for a spirit, because it's the Spirit that's going to lead and direct us in the ways of truth. Let's go to some foundational scripture. Some foundational. I don't have no doubt that the Spirit gonna do the work of the Spirit. Any brothers and sisters that's out there that's not a part of no religious organization, that don't read the Bible or don't go to nobody's church, anybody that's in that condition, right, you are not at all excluded from the video. There is something for everybody. So, and we say that because we make these videos. I'm not no religious dude. I deal with real life, hardcore real life, hot off the press, point blank and period. You know why we deal with real life? Because I'm a real man living in a real world, got real sin, got real struggles, got real problems. Ain't nobody gonna classify me as no fake, falsified, hiding in the dark, hypocritical Sunday morning preacher that portrays himself to be something that he really ain't once the door closed, once the light go off. Ain't nobody gonna put me in a category of no so-called hypocritical, falsified, fake out front, pretending camp leader, Sabbath day teacher, bishop, apostle, no other title wearing joker. I ain't going in there. I'm your brother. By me being your brother, I can pull all my clothes off, strip myself down to the bare butt naked to make every last one of you come to understand there is none that is righteous. There is none that do good and not evil. All of us have fallen short of the Most High's glory. And if we ever going to find the Father's righteousness, that means that we're going to have to buckle up under the weight of the word, and we're going to have to start hearing the voice of the Messiah. Now, many people say that they serve in the Messiah. Many people say that they follow in his footsteps. Many people say that they receive their instruction from the Messiah. Yet, when you start talking to people, you understand that they are coming back telling you what other people said. So you ain't hearing the voice of the Messiah. You're hearing the voice of everybody else. When we tell our brothers and sisters, all of them, man, don't tell me nothing about Torah. Don't tell me nothing about Torah. And then you talking about Yahshua HaMashiach in one side of your mouth, and then you talking about Torah or the Levitical priesthood, or you talking about the law of Moses, which really wasn't no law of Moses. Don't tell me none of that nonsense. And you got the Messiah on the other side of your mouth. If you really hear sheep, then you're going to hear his voice. Problem is, we can't hear his voice without the Spirit, because it's the Spirit's job to lead us and guide us into ways of truth. So you ain't got the Messiah's voice. What's right, what's written in red, in red ink in the KJV 66 books only represent about 3% of the life of the Messiah. How you gonna say you hear his voice when you ain't even got no examples of the life that he lived? And if you ain't hearing the voice of the Spirit, then where is your leadership gonna come? How you gonna get led? This is why I tell brothers, when they start talking that nonsense about canonization, Greek terminology, rule, rod, stick, or something whereby a thing can be measured by, but it'll be measured according to Greek culture. Don't come telling me nothing about no canonization. God can't be canonized. God can't be canonized. So the Spirit leads us to places where we can hear the voice of the Messiah. And that's what we're going to do. And when we hear the voice of the Messiah, that's where we're going to come forth from. So what we're going to do, we're going to go into some things, and I'm going to show you something. Let's go to this foundation of scripture right here. Let's go to this foundational scripture passage right here. Oh, man, I feel the Spirit already. I feel the Spirit. You ain't going to tell me nothing about the power of the Spirit. When we get genuine, we get right down to the nitty-gritty, strip ourselves butt naked before the Most High. I am less than. I am nothing without you. I can't breathe without, I can't move without you. And if you don't raise me up, if you don't give me the words to speak, I won't have nothing to speak. You ain't going to tell me nothing about the operation of the Spirit, because the Spirit don't move according to information that is written with ink and paper. Spirit moves in a whole nother realm. So we're going to go here with a foundation. We're going to set the tone for this video right here. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that this video, if you thought flesh and blood video was something, got the whole Israelite community in an uproar right now. Well, I'm going to tell you now, you better hold on to your hat. Because when we start telling you stuff like, you can throw all your books away, go put them out there on your barbecue grill, put some lighter fluid on and set them on fire. I can imagine how people going to feel when I tell them, go on and throw your apocrypha away. Go throw your KJV away. Go throw every other book away that you ever thought you had that was going to change your life. Ain't none of them going to be able to change your life. Only the Spirit is going to do that. We already know. No man wants to come to identify the fact that he is up under the will of demons. Not even my own self. But you keep walking. You keep on walking, you keep on growing, you keep on learning. You keep jumping up every morning, looking in the mirror, analyzing your life. Why this ain't fixed? Why I ain't over this? Why I ain't got that right yet? Why is my mindset still like this? Why is my attitude still bad like this? Why can't I control my mouth? When you're jumping up every morning and you're looking yourself in the face and you're seeing the same things there that existed long before you went to church, long before you knew that you was an Israelite. You know you're an Israelite now, but that ain't got the power to morph your life into what God mean for you to be. So you got to start analyzing. There's a problem somewhere. And wherever the problem is, we got to find a way to get our hands around the throat of it so they can come down. Now, we believe beyond a shadow of a doubt that the answers are in the... We got the answer. Foundational scripture. We're going to pray, as we said, that the Spirit just going to give utterance. I got some things in my head, but I don't know how I'm going to get them out there, but I don't have no doubt. When we relinquish and yield ourselves to the work of the Spirit does works that no man have the capability of doing. Let's go see. Yeah. I'm going to challenge some of our brothers that say that they serve in the Messiah. Take heed that no man deceive you. In the last days, many shall come saying, I represent Christ. I serve Christ. I follow Christ. And they shall deceive many people. They're going to say it. Just because they say it don't mean that that's what it is. Let's go to John 10th chapter. John 10th chapter. Let's go to John 10th chapter. We're going to use this book. I'm going to show you some things. John 10th chapter. We're going to start at the 4th verse. Let's start reading at the first verse. Verily I say unto you, he that enter in not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, is the same as a thief. You see, there's a preset protocol to which a man comes in to the grace of Hamashiach by faith. There was a set standard. There's a way that you got to do it. He said, if you try to do it any other way, you're as a thief and you're as a robber. So let's look at what he's saying first. Then we'll come back and we'll put some things on top of it. Verily I say unto you, he that entereth in not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same is as a thief and a robber. But he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter openeth, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calleth his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. And when he put forth his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. Now that's the Messiah. That's the Messiah talking about. Now anybody that ever say that they want to follow the Messiah, you understand this. There ain't but one way to do that. You got to hear his voice. And you following somebody else's voice, you ain't his sheep. Because here it says his sheep, they don't follow nobody else's voice. All other voice are strange to the sheep. They ain't following nobody else. So if you're talking about, oh, I'm following Hamashiach, or Yahshua is Lord, Jesus is Lord, I'm blessed, I'm high. You say you following the sheep, but you listening to every other voice in the Bible. You ain't his sheep. His sheep can't listen. They can't hear no other voice. Their ears have literally been blocked out to any other voice, because all other voices are strange voices. You his sheep. But you talking about laws, statutes, and commandments, and judgments, which the Most High didn't give. You his sheep, right? But you don't understand that he fought against the priesthood. He fought against the Levites. He fought against the Torah. He fought against the Old Testament laws. He fought against all of those things, right alongside by side the prophets that his father sent. How you gonna be his sheep? How you gonna be hearing his voice, but you listening to somebody else? I'm gonna show you how. We're going to start right here with the foundational scripture. Another one. Let's go over here. Check this here out. This is the temptation of Yeshua HaMashiach. This is the 35th chapter of the Nazarene Act of the Apostles. This we will have you to know assuredly, that a demon has no power against a man unless one voluntarily submits himself to his desires. So when I say that we have all been subjected, we have been up under the subjection of demons on a multiplicity of areas in our life, even until this day. This is what I mean. You see, because anytime you hear any other voice outside of the appointed heir over all things, you have now allowed yourself to become subjected to the will of a demon. And that don't mean that I called your Torah, called your forefathers demons. I said you allow yourself to be subjected up under the will of a demon, because that time have come and gone, and God ain't operating like that no more. God, who at sundry time and diverse manners in time past spoke to the prophets, and they spoke to the fathers who rejected what the prophet spoke, hath in these last days speaking to us by his son, who have been appointed heir over all things. His sheep will hear his voice, because he is the appointed heir over all things. And if you're hearing somebody else's voice, then you have willingly made yourself subjected up under the will of a demon that's trying to get you to go against the grain of God's methodology and his new reinstitution of how his will is going to get done in the earth. You see, and many of you don't understand that you have voluntarily subjected yourself up under the will of demons. I tell you who demons are. Let's get right down into the nitty-gritty of it. I show you who the demons are. The demons are anybody that refuses to hear the voice of Yeshua HaMashiach and go against the grain of the appointed heir. And when you see anybody going against the grain of the appointed heir, let that be a record to you that you have submitted yourself to the will of a demon. Why would you follow a man that refuses to hear the voice of the Messiah? You tell me. Somebody tell me. Why would you follow a man? I'm going to show you how to spot a demon. Then we're going to show you why. Let's see. Let's go here. Matthew chapter 23, verse 4. No man, no demon has no power over a man unless a man voluntarily submits himself to the will of a demon. You want to see who's demons in the world? Who the modern day demons that's operating in falsehoods and unrighteousness because they will not hear the voice of the one that they say that they believe in? Let's see. I'm going to show you who they are. This, you'll know them by what they do. Verse 4 of the 23rd chapter. For they are bind heavy burdens, grievous to be borne on men. Lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. But everything that they do to be seen of men. When you look in your world that you're living in, and you see the people that's always trying to tell you what you should be doing, what you shouldn't be doing, what you should be doing, what you shouldn't be doing. You got to do this. You got to do that. You got to keep this. I don't care what this church. You got to come to Sunday school. You got to come to Wednesday night Bible study. You got to come to the pastor and wife anniversary. You got to come to the deacon board meeting. You got to come to the usher meeting. You got to come to choir. When you see somebody, you know you're up under the will of demons.
They were buying heavy burdens upon men's shoulders, grievous to be born. When you see your brothers out, you got to keep the laws. You got to keep the statute. You got to keep the judgment of the Most High. You got to keep the feast days. You got to keep the feast of week, the feast of booth, the feast of tabernacle. You got to keep the Sabbath. When you see brothers buying their heavy burdens that are grievous to be born on men's shoulders, knowing full well, they ain't going to Wednesday night Bible study. They ain't going to the deacon board. They ain't going to choir rehearsal. They ain't going to Sunday school. They ain't going to the feast day, the Sabbath class. They ain't doing all of these things that they trying to tell everybody else to do. But no demon has the power over no man unless a man willingly submits himself. Why would you submit yourself to the will of a demon when you can submit yourself to the shepherd that you say that you're following? Why would I want to follow in the footsteps of unrighteous men when I can walk in the footsteps of the righteous one that came to be put to death on my behalf? Why would I want to do it? Why would I want to be, so to say, pretending? Why do I want to counterfeit when I can have the real thing, baby? I don't need you, pastor. I don't need you, bishop. Apostle, what I need you for? When I got the appointed heir over all things, what do I need you for, general? What do I need you for, captain? What do I need you for, deacon? What do I need any of you, rot gut, no good, conniving jokers for? When I can reach for the original, what do I need you for? This is what I keep telling you, brothers and sisters. You keep on wanting to be men pleasers and in the buddy-buddy club, and you want to be a part of this mess, so you're learning the ways of heathens. Learn not the way of the heathen. So you want to look good and look charismatic, so you want to be out there on the corner. You want to do what they do. Why would you want to do all of that nonsense when you could just go straight to the one that said, my sheep hear my voice? You talking about you serving the Messiah and you out here following niggas out there on the corner that's cussing people out and talking all kind of nonsense and calling the white man Esau and all mixed up and calling Israel every other nation on the planet. Why would you want to follow these fools? I ain't taking it back. I ain't taking none of it back. Anybody that think they got a problem with, you can step up here, bring your books, bring your notepad, bring all your books. You can even bring your pistols, because many of your spirit is so foul that you'll go out here and kill somebody. Why would you want to follow a counterfeit when you can have the real thing? See? I told y'all, you ain't putting me in no box. I'm who I am. I'm who I am. I ain't no perfect man. Don't claim to be. I ain't even trying to be perfect. I'm just trying to live my life. Somebody gleaned something off the video. That's wonderful. If they don't, then guess what, baby? When I'm looking in this camera, I got a face that's staring right back at me. And that word that's coming out is coming right speaking to me about my own foolishness. First, I'm the one that got to take the first slap on the face. No demon has power over a man unless a man voluntarily submits himself to the demon. But see, the problem is that many of the brothers and sisters can't see who the demon is, because the demons ain't going to teach you what's right. They're going to seduce you into doing what they want you to do. You ain't never going to hear. You ain't never going to hear the shepherd's voice. You ain't never going to hear the shepherd's voice. Yeah. I'm an emotional being. That's how God made me, King. Yeah, I'm an emotional being. And I may be emotional, but it ain't going to change this word that's coming at you. See, that's what you got to look at. You can thrust or lash out at me and how I'm wired together and how I'm put together, but what you can't do is you ain't going to be able to stop this word that's coming at you. You see? And it must be something about my emotions that you like. See it how every time the video come on, you right there. But hang around. Hang around. I'm going to show you how you're going to spot these demons. Because this is where you'll know demons by what they do. That's right. That's right, Yakanan. I know it's all love. You know I'm emotional. That don't be me, though. If you sit down and talk to me, anybody that know me, you sit down and talk to me, that ain't me. That is not me. I can sit down, man, in my spirit. I'm just as calm and cool and collective and unexcited and unmoved. But I don't know what it is.
I've even prayed and asked the Most High, Lord, help me tone it down, please. Help me just say, nah, you ain't wired like that. When I get like that, it's because I feel something. I feel some stuff on the inside. Let's check this here out. Now, remember, no demon has a power over man. Shouts out to you, Sister Lisa. Lisa Roberts, my Kansas City sister. No demon has power over man unless a man voluntarily submits himself to it. See, we give the demons to all the wrong things. Okay, listen. Hey, listen. I got a background of drugs in my past. Now, I never classified myself as no addict because I went to work every day, took care of my business, paid my bills, dressed good, looked good, rolled good, and still did what I did. But down on the inside, hey, if a problem was a problem, I would submit myself to the will of demons. But man, couldn't no crack just jump out of nobody's pocket? It couldn't just jump in my mouth? It could just jump in the paper, roll itself up? Couldn't no weed just jump out there and roll itself up? Couldn't no alcohol just jump out the bottle and jump in my body? Couldn't a woman just open her legs up and then it just jump in? It happened like that. You see, you have to voluntarily submit yourself unto a thing in order for it to have power over you. Once you have submitted yourself to it, now it can have controlling power over you. And the demons in this modern day time we're talking about men. Because men are the seducers in this world. They are up under demons. We are up under demons and don't even understand it. That's why unless somebody start hearing the voice of the Spirit, and the Spirit start really making you see some things for what they really are, you'll see it crystal clear. Everybody that's on this thread right now, if you don't believe that you are up under the will and influence of a demon, I want you to put a 7 up in there. Everybody that's on this thread, if you believe that you are not subjected to the will of a demon, I want you to put a 7 up there. Listen at this. He say the demons, they love to be seen before men. Because you got to understand that when you start talking about demons, you start talking about Genesis chapter 6 now. You see? And it was giants in earth before those days and after that. When the sons of God seen the daughters of men were fair, they took to them wives and went into them, and then they made it with them. He said, and then they sons became men of old and men of renown. So they were men of old because they had advanced knowledge, because they come from another dimension. But they were men of renown because they were great in stature. They had great, their bodies were, they was great in stature. So when it's talking about you being able to see the modernized demon for what they are, they want to be portrayed great in this world. They don't no longer have the 16 to 36 foot body anymore. God took their body away. But when they can get a yielded vessel, you see, now they can be great in stature through that one. So the demons, they love to be greeted in the marketplace, called by all sorts of titles. That's what he said. They love it. Rabbi, rabbi. Pastor, pastor. Go in, go in. No matter how many of these videos we make, they don't go and change it. I don't think it's a person on there that has seen these videos and then came back and stopped. Hey man, don't call me pastor no more. Hey, don't call me bishop no more. Hey, don't call me. You see it in the word, but I don't think they done went and did it. You know why? Because it's a manifestation that's how demons operate. They want to be seen as great ones in this world. But the Messiah, the shepherd, is saying, my sheep hear my voice. If he give you instruction telling you don't do this, you are all brothers. There is no room for one to be high and one to be low. All of us must be on the same plateau. So when you see brothers still doing it, what you see is you see those that are not hearing. the voice of the shepherd. You got brothers out here calling themselves shepherd. And you got people out here calling men shepherd. How foolish is that? How foolish is it for a man to call another man shepherd? Oh, shepherd. Oh, shepherd. Oh, shepherd. You shepherd, you better get out of here with that mess. You ain't nobody's shepherd. I wish you would step in my face talking about you somebody's shepherd. I got something for you. I'll shepherd you all right. Oh, shepherd. Oh, shepherd. That's a demon. That ain't no shepherd. Because the Messiah already told that demon, don't be called by these things. And if it was a sheep, if he was a sheep, he would not allow the other sheep to address him in the manner that they address the shepherd. Man, I ain't even got nowhere near to where I was going. So, the Messiah says, be not called by titles, for one is your master, even I. Why he say be not called by titles? He said, because I am the appointed heir over all men. Therefore, the titles of men existed for a season, but once I got here, he said, I'm the appointed heir over all men. So I don't want you running around here thinking, making your brother think that you know better than him. I want you to understand that you're all brothers. You only have one master. I'm the master over everything. Now, what? Now tell me which one of these jokers are hearing the shepherd's voice. You don't talk about you a sheep? You ain't no sheep. Get out of here with that mess. And anybody following you got to be out of their damn mind. Because why you gonna keep following a man when all you got to do is get in your closet and pray that the Spirit would lead you into ways of truth like the Messiah said he would. And let the Spirit lead you. Why would you do it? I don't understand it. But then again, I do understand it. So, we're gonna see why they do it. And we're gonna see crystal clear whose will these brothers are being subjected to. We're also going to get to see crystal clear who our will has been subjected to. I myself had to come to the realization that I have allowed myself to be willingly subjected to the will of demons. It was easy for me to accept that fact. When you're talking about the things that we were dealing with, life and drugs and sex and you know, and all that dope selling. See, it was easy for me to accept the fact that I was willingly subjected up under the will of demons for that stuff right there. How do you accept the fact that you've been up under the will of a demon while you're reading the Bible? How do you get that through? How do you get to that point to where you can accept that? Oh, I know, baby, that sounds just as crazy as it wanted to. Well, that's what I thought too, but I'm telling you, the truth is as a ladder, and every day, new truth is revealed that will cause you to forget what you learned yesterday and challenge you to the up degree into your tomorrow. Come on. So the foundation of this video is going to be, my sheep hear my voice and they will not follow another. And the flip side is that anybody that's following another voice have been willingly subjected themselves to the will of demons. Now, what we want to do now, I want to make clear how we have been subjected to the will of demons. Just with the things that we learn. Because one of the things I tell brothers and sisters all the time, man, the Bible never was meant to replace your life as an individual. You can glean a few good things out there, and you know what? And every day, new truth is coming, new book is coming, and all of this stuff. And you know what? What's happening is that men immediately gravitate toward these things that they see, these things that they read, and immediately they start moving and operating their life by them. They don't understand. You're up under the will of a demon. You're up under the will of a demon. You're up under the will of a demon. And I'll tell you why you're up under the will of a demon. Because Hamashiach said, it's expedient for me that I go. For if I go not away, then the Comforter or the Spirit will not come. But when he come, who I will send to you from the Father, he shall lead you and guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever thing he hear, that shall he speak. And he shall show you things to come. You see? So when I tell you, you can go throw your book out there on a barbecue pit, put some chalk on lighter fluid on it, and let it puff up in the smoke, I'm going to ask you a question. What do you think it'll be like if there was no more books in the world? If every book in the world was destroyed, do you think that a man could still find God's righteousness in this world? Somebody answer that question. If every man threw his Bible and his books away, do you think that he could still find God's righteousness in this world? I'll wait on the answer.
Oh, so-called elder, he out there tripping. He telling everybody to throw their Bible. I ain't told you nothing. When you start hearing the voice of the shepherd, that's the one that tell you. He said, because the Spirit now is going to become the replacement for every other thing that had been previously done until my arrival. Once I got here, everything that you once knew don't mean nothing. I'll tell you, tear all the pages out of Levitical priesthood. Tear the whole Torah out. Tear all the books of Moses out. Tear everything that you thought that you had and just throw it away. Don't say I said it. Don't say I said it. I didn't say it.
Why would he say that? Why would he say that the Spirit is going to lead you and guide you into ways of truth and show you things to come? Do you not understand that showing you things to come are pertaining to the things that's coming in the future that have never been written with pen and paper? How are you going to see something in the future except the Spirit show it to you? He going to show you things to come. Do you think the Spirit going to come and redirect your attention backward to something that been here all the way up until he got here? What kind of sense does that make? When I tell you that the Messiah is coming to remove you from the books, you got to understand that the books have done some great damage to the whole world from eternity, unto this very day. Men have erred because of the things that have been written with ink and paper. And right now, as men read more and read more and read more, it's more war, more confusion, more everything coming, simply because that is not what the Most High meant for us. We have been voluntarily subjected ourselves to the will of demons and don't know it. We're going to figure it out. So when we start looking at the voice of the Messiah, he said the Spirit going to come. The Spirit going to lead you. The Spirit going to guide you. The Spirit going to teach you in ways of truth. Solomon said that the Most High would pour his Spirit out on us. The prophet said that the Most High would pour his Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. They shall prophesy and they shall see visions. They shall dream dreams. He didn't say the Most High was going to pour out all these other things. You know the reason why the books are opening up? The books are opening up is because we have been separated from the life of the Messiah. When you see the life of the Messiah, you can understand what the Messiah is doing. That's why the Messiah said, we said in the last video, we read the scripture, we'll read it again. See, because sometimes people hear what they want to hear. Watch this here. Watch this here. If you don't think that the Messiah came to remove us from books, you got another thing coming. But here's the $6 million question. You have to ask yourself why. Why would the Messiah come to remove us from the very Bible that's speaking of him? I tell you why. Because the very Bible ain't speaking of him. The very Bible ain't speaking of him. It's speaking of everything else. But where it would be speaking of him, they took all that stuff out because he was going to come and remove us from it. It never was meant for us to do these things. And as we go along in this video, eventually we're going to see it. So people have the right to think what you want to think and feel how you want to feel. And if you want to comment, go on and make your comment, because we're going to unravel what we're saying if it's not coming across clear. Now the Messiah said, now I speak to you in the tongue, in the living tongue of the living God, through the Holy Spirit of our Heavenly Father. There is none among you that can understand all of this that I speak. Why is that? Because we gonna understand what's being spoken. God, who has sundry time in diverse manners in times past, he spoke. He didn't write. He spoke to the prophets. And they spoke to the forefathers. In these last days, he is speaking to us by his Son, who had been appointed heir over all things by who the world was framed. The Son appointed the Spirit. He said, howbeit when the Spirit comes, he shall lead you and guide you in the ways of truth, for he shall not speak of himself. But whatsoever he hear me speak. You see? You see, the Spirit is redirecting us back to the spoken things of the Most High, not to the things that were written by the words of men or by the hands of men. And here you got a pen in the scripture. And now I speak to you in the living tongue of God through the Holy Spirit of our Heavenly Father. There is none of you that can understand all of this which I speak. He who expounds the scriptures speaks to you in a dead tongue of dead men through his diseased and mortal body. Him, therefore, can all men understand, for all men are diseased and in death. No one sees the light of life. Blind man lead blind man on dark path of sin, diseases, and sufferings. And at last, they fall into a pit. You see the difference? You see the line of distinction? He said, I'm speaking to you in the living tongue of the living God, through the Holy Spirit of our Heavenly Father. But he who expounds on the scripture, he who is dealing with the things that are written with ink and paper, is expounding in the words of dead men. And by this standard, all men can comprehend them, because all of us have been made subjected up under the will of the same demons. That ain't enough for you? That ain't enough. Let's go back. Let's go over here. And Yeshua sat himself down in their midst and said, I tell you truly, none can be happy except they do the law. And the others answered, we all do the law of Moses, our lawgiver, even as they are written in the Holy Scripture. And Jesus answered and said, seek not the law in your scriptures. For the law is life, whereas the scripture is dead. I tell you truly, Moses received not his laws from God in writing, but through the living word. The law is living word of living God, the living prophets for living men. In everything that is life is the law written. In everything that is life, in everything that is life, in everything that is life is the law written. God so made life and all living things that they, God so made life and all living things that they, life and all living things that they might by the everlasting word teach the laws of the true God to man. So if God made life and all things that live, that they might teach the everlasting words, or the everlasting word and law of the true God, then guess what? What God have we been serving? You see, because if we have not been learning from the things that God put here to teach us, then we have been learning something that we never was supposed to be learning in the first place. Because if we was learning what God meant for us to learn, the whole world would be turned upside right back now. But now everybody got the Bible, everybody got the book, everybody got the Apocrypha, and 1,000 other books. Every religion got a book. Islam got the Quran, Jehovah's Witness got the New World Translation, Hinduism got their book, everybody got their own book. But the world is in total chaos, and ain't nobody learning the laws of the true God, because we won't pay attention to where God had written his laws down. This henceforth did Hamashiach say, I have come that I will send the Spirit into the world. He shall lead you and he shall guide you in the truth, and he shall show you things to come. So
It's like, what you gonna believe? Something come and shake the very foundation of everything that you ever thought you knew. You come to the place the way you understand, I don't know nothing. I know anything. No matter how much learning, I'm learning. I'm up some subjected to the will of demons when I'm not learning in the way that the Most High meant for me to learn. When I start learning of the life of the Messiah, now I understand what the Most High. It is the life of the Messiah that is redirecting the mind's understanding back to the true laws of God's righteousness and how he's going to begin his learning process. Oh, but if all the thing you thinking about is some camp, some church, some Sabbath day class, going to eat some animal? Going to eat some animal? Because let me tell you something about this stuff. Let's just keep it real. A lot of this stuff from church to these camp organizations and everything, it ain't nothing but a replacement for the world, the so-called world that they left behind. They don't want to do nothing but get together and go party and go kick it and go drink and go eat and go barbecue, then go jump in the bed and start fornicating and having sex with each other and all the while talking about that they serving the Most High. His sheep hear his voice. They ain't gonna follow nobody. He knew that that was the same corrupt stuff that they done at the base of the mountain when they made the molten calf. They doing the same thing. When Moses got near to the camp, he heard the music. He heard the dancing. He seen the singing. He seen the riotousness. He seen the wine. He seen the drinking. He seen the sacrifice. And the Most High declared, Moses, get thee down off of this mountain, for thy children have corrupted thyself. Listen. Ain't no new things under the sun. Church the same way. These jokers ain't in church because their heart been changed. They ain't in church because they hearing the voice of the Messiah. You hearing the voice of a charlatan. You hearing the voice of a man constantly begging you for something. Hey, give me 10% of your income. He telling you things that God never spoke. God never meant for you to do. Listen. This ain't personal. This is real life. And because I'm your brother, I ain't in no popularity contest. I got the right. I'll tell you what I think about it. You can tell me what you think about me too. Man, this stuff is real. People that's genuinely trying to serve them, trying to find the right way, the righteous path. It ain't but one way you're going to do it. You have to start separating yourself from men. You have to start pulling yourself away from all these books, all this information, all this stuff. Listen, that stuff ain't going to add no righteousness to your life. When you start learning of the life of the Messiah, just like we learning right here, let me read it again. See, a lot of times we start reading things that people have become so accustomed, that's what it's like to be up under the wheel of a demon. Because when you're up under the wheel of a demon, it's called a seducing spirit. It's almost like you got a spell cast on you. You want to hold on to what you know, even though you can see, even though you can see. You can see. But he said, oh no, I just can't accept that. I just can't accept that. Well, you ain't got to accept that. Now, the only reason why you can't accept it is because you got so preoccupied with hearing the voices of strangers that you can no longer hear the voice of the true one. And Yeshua answered and said, seek not the law in your scripture. How simplistic is that? Seek not the law in your scripture. How simplistic is that? You got to keep the laws. You got to keep the statutes. You got to keep the commandments. You got to keep the judgment. Well, where are the laws, the statutes, the commandments, and the judgments? Where are they located? Or are they not located in what they call the scripture? And here you got the shepherd coming along saying, seek not the laws in your scripture. Seek not the laws in your scripture. Seek not the laws in your scripture. So who you going to believe? Either you're going to believe your brothers who say that the law is in the scripture, or you're going to believe the one that you say that you're following who say that the law ain't in the scripture and tell you where the law is that. He said, in all things, God made all things that have life and all things that live. There is where his laws is written. And by these were the were meant to teach the everlasting word and the true laws unto mankind in all the things that have life. So it comes down to who you're going to listen to, who you're going to pay attention to. Either you're going to hear the voice of the Messiah and you're going to start learning from where God put his true laws in the air, in the creation, in the birds, in all the things that have life that teach us how we are supposed to govern ourselves in this world. That is where we find righteousness at. You see, you start looking at God's law, baby. You ain't gonna think about eating no dog. You ain't thinking about eating no cat, no Chinese food. You ain't thinking about eating no lamb on Saturday. You ain't thinking about eating no rat and all that mess, because you ate all of them things, not knowingly, by all these people that you've been frequently patronizing. You've eaten all these things. But when you start looking at God's laws, you see, your mind has changed. You're talking about having your life changed. Ain't no words in no Bible ever been able to change a man's life, morph no man's life into righteousness. Some of you still fornicating, been reading the scripture for years. Some of you still committing adultery. Some of you still been in the Bible, in church, inside, still done been through divorce, still ain't got control over the kids, still ain't got the right relationship with your husband and your wife, and you're reading the Bible on a daily basis. Them words don't have the ability to transform nobody's life, but I dare you to start looking where the laws of the Most High are written. You got to be still, and you got to be quiet for that. Going to church every Sunday. You ain't tell me nothing. You ain't tell me nothing. I'm going out of church, get right out of church, go jump straight in another woman's bed that wasn't my wife. I can get out of church, go straight into the club. Get out of church, go straight to the crack house. Get out of church, go straight sell my brother's stuff. I can get out of church, go got my pistol already in the car. Ain't no church changed nobody's life. Ain't nothing the preacher said changed nobody's life. Might made you feel good. You might have got a few chills. You might even drop a tear as you thought about yourself. But you come right out there doing the same thing. You don't tell me nothing about that. Ain't no Sabbath day class gonna make a sister keep her legs closed. Ain't no Sabbath day class gonna do that. It ain't gonna happen. So it's either you're going to listen to what the Messiah say, or you're going to listen to what men say. Messiah say, seek not the law in your scripture, for the law is life. Who can say different? When I tell you seek not the law in your scripture, when I tell you that the law is life, which is greater? The scripture, which is dead, it don't have the ability to move, it can't walk, it can't breathe, it can't get up and help nobody, it can't reach in his pocket and pull out $2 or $3. Which one is greater? The scripture which is dead, or the law which is life, which is living? Which is greater, this or life? Which would you rather have? Would you exchange your life to be in the position of a book that can't move? Ain't nobody want to talk back to me today. We're trying to show you something. And we're going to show you. We're going to show you. But we're going to make a couple of videos. But we're going to climax it. Listen. Good God Almighty. Oh, man. Sometimes I think to myself, why you let me see these things? And then it's a challenge because I don't always understand how to explain it. That's what makes the videos controversial. That I know that people don't be fully understanding what's being said at that particular time. I know that. But it don't change what's in my mind. I know what's in my mind is as real as the breath that's coming out in and out of my body. We've been subjected up under the wheel of demons, not knowingly. So let's see why the Messiah said, don't seek the law in your scripture. I'm going to show you why. This is why he came to remove us from the books. This is why he appointed the spirit. This is why he telling you that your scripture is dead. He telling us these things because when we look at the world that we're living in, and we look at the damage that the books have caused amongst brothers and sisters that are supposed to be serving God, can't get along. The flesh eater wants to hate the non non-flesh eater. The one that's following Jesus is wants the one that's following Paul wants to hate the one that's following Jesus. The one that's following the prophets is you know, the one that's following the Torah is hating the one that's following the prophets. And everybody got the same book. Everybody can find scripture that they can justify. It's so, okay, it was right here in Exodus 29. We can eat flesh. But over here in Jeremiah, it says God never told you to eat flesh. Over here, you can find it over here in Leviticus where the priest was dissecting. Cut the animal up here. Cut the animal up here. And God said burn this part over here and kill this part over here. And over here, you see God saying, he who kills an ox is as a man that kills. He who kills an ox is as a man that kills another man. See, everything is mixed up, but it's all in the Bible. It's all in there. So Jesus said, seek not the law of the Most High in your scripture. I'm coming to take you away from that. And there's a reason behind it. But many of us have never understood what the reason was because we've been subjected to the will of demons. We will never learn the truth in its fullness. But when we come up under the Spirit will lead us to places that we never even envisioned that we would be. Show us things in our mind. Bring us in contact with things that's coming in ways to where we now can have a better comprehension. Let me show you. I'm not going to hold it anymore. Why did the Messiah come to remove us from books? Seek not the law in your scripture. For the law is life, whereas the scripture is dead. Moses did not receive his laws from God in writing, but through the living word. Through the living word. Now, Moses didn't receive his laws from God in writing, but through the living word. Now listen at this. All living things are nearer to God than the scripture, which is without life. God so made life in all things living that they might by the everlasting word teach the laws of the true God to man. God wrote not his laws in pages of books, but in your heart and in your spirit. And it's been the thing that's written in pages and books that have caused the whole world to be in corruption. The Messiah coming. Because he understood. He's from everlasting to everlasting. And he understood how it got like this. And when we start looking and asking ourselves questions, well, why, Father? Well, why? We got the Bible. So why would you have to send the Messiah into the world? So that makes me understand that everything in the Bible ain't what it's supposed to be. Okay? Okay, well, when the Messiah came, well, why you got to send the Spirit? And the Spirit going to lead us in the truth. Well, how you going to lead us in the truth that we already got? Then you come to understand. Well, by the Spirit, you don't have the truth. That thing that you have, that ain't the truth. It ain't never been the truth. If it was the truth, then the Messiah wouldn't have had to come. And if it was the truth, then the Messiah would have pointed you back toward that. But because he didn't, he appointed you to the Spirit and then told the Spirit to propel you forward away from that mess, as far away from it as you can get. So you go on and keep listening to your camp brothers spewing all of that camp doctrine that they're talking about. Go on and keep listening to these pastors and these preachers. If you go on and keep listening to all broke down wicked men, charlatan men, men that love preeminence, lovers of themselves, the boys club, the lovers of the men club that want to get together all the time. You know, you go on and be a part of that. But as for me and my house, we'll follow in the footsteps of the one that said, how be it when the Spirit comes, he shall lead you, he shall guide you, he shall only speak of me. We know that whatever the Spirit speaks, It's true. I can take that to the bank. I ain't got to second guess it. I ain't got to go get a second opinion. I ain't got to ask nobody what they think. That's why when we do the videos, we don't ask people what they think. We don't care what nobody thinks. It's come directly from the spirit. We'll come out the closet. We'll go in the closet, Clark Kent, and come out Superman, spitting out word you ain't never heard before in your life, showing you things in the scripture that you ain't never seen in your life. And we're about to show you something right now to help brothers and sisters understand why, if you don't come out of these books and come back to where you're supposed to be, you're going to be in trouble. Nothing is wrong with learning. Nothing is wrong with learning, but there is a balance that has to be had when it comes to learning. You weren't meant to be living your book based on things that have been pre-written and recorded thousands of years before you got here. If you sacrificed the life that God gave you to live now, how is this magnificent glory going to be made manifest in this 21st century? You tell me. Let me show you why the Messiah is coming to remove us from books. I'm just going to start with some. I want to do something first before we get there. Bear with me one second. Because we got some hypocrites out there. We got some hypocrites out there that they say one thing out of side of one side of their mouth. Then they say something else out the side of the other mouth. So when we start talking about, because what we're going to do, we're going to look at the book of Enoch. We know that Enoch is contained in the sixth chapter of the book of Genesis, and dealing with Noah and all that. Enoch walked with God and then he was not. God translated. God took him away. So we're going to look at some particular things to bring you up to the place of why the Messiah, why Yahshua is going to remove you. Why he's saying if you don't come out of that King James 66 version Bible and get your butt in that closet, you're going to be in trouble. If you don't come out of all this Sabbath day teaching and camp stuff and all these churches, if you don't bring your butt out of that stuff and get in a closet where you can hear my voice, you're going to be part of the many that will come in the last days saying, Lord, Lord, did not we preach? Did not we prophesy? Did not we cast out devils and do many? He'll declare, I never knew you. I never knew you. You was one that worked iniquity. Now you classified me as the shepherd, but you never heard my voice. You didn't walk with me. You said that I was your Lord, but you was listening to everybody else. Depart from me. You that work iniquity, you'll be part of the many that declare, I'm Israel. I'm Israel. Well, you ain't nothing, because many, many nations shall come from the east and the west, shall sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, yet the children of the kingdom, the one that the shepherd came to save, for all come for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. You won't tell me that the shepherd can come to get you, but you won't hear his voice. You'll be part of the many that will sit with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Yet you as his children will go into outer darkness. It's not meet for me to take the children's bread and give it to the dog, but the children of the kingdom have been prophesied to go into outer darkness because they refuse to hear the shepherd's voice only. You can't hear the shepherd's voice and the Levitical priest at the same time. You can't hear the shepherd's voice and Moses at the same time. You can't hear the shepherd's voice and the prophets at the same. You can't hear the shepherd's voice and the apostle Paul to Timothy. You can't hear the shepherd's voice and no other voice. I am the Lord. I'll share my glory with no one. You can't hear the shepherd's voice with nobody. That's how that goes. Oh, sweetie. It's open. Man, I was hoping that you didn't catch me making the video.
You're alright. Hello, everyone.
My sweetie just made it home from work.
Hi, Mama.
See? So, let's go here and let's look at this. Because you got some of my brothers out there. I don't subscribe to the book of Enoch. But they believe in angels. I'll subscribe to the book of Enoch. Well, let me show you something. For any brother out there that say that they don't subscribe to the book of Enoch, I want you to look in the light that you live and we start bringing out some of these things. And you tell me if any of these things that's contained in these books
is prevalent right now in your life. And I guarantee you, I can find where even those that say they don't subscribe have made themselves subjected up under the wheel of demons. And when I asked the question earlier, I didn't get no feedback or no answer. I asked, is there anybody on this thread that think that they have been subjected to the wheel of demons? Nobody said nothing. Nobody wants to believe that they have been subjected to the wheel of demons. But in order for us, when we start hearing the shepherd's voice, the shepherd makes it clear, hey man, that's not me right there. You subjected up under the wheel of a demon. Come on, you got to hear me, boy. Come on out of there. When we start hearing, see the Messiah, the shepherd, he show us things by the Spirit. The Spirit is able to separate, like I said, able to divide all the way, separate from marrow, from bone. You understand? The Spirit deal with the intent and the motive of the heart. The Spirit deals with things that's so deep down on a man's inside that the Spirit, your mind can't even escape it. That's the Spirit. So if the Spirit don't show us that we've been subjected to the wheel of demons, then that's how we manage to stay bound. When we can acknowledge I've been subjected, I subjected myself willingly up under the wheel of a demon. When I understand that, then that's 50% of my fight, my battle won. The rest is just fighting to overcome it. But there are many times we've been subjected up under the wheel of demons and have no idea. And so when we start hearing the voice of the Spirit, the voice of the Spirit helps us to see things that we never knew were there. So let's go here. Chapter 6 of the book of Enoch. And it came to pass that when children of men had multiplied in those days, were born to them beautiful and comely daughters. And the angels, the children of heaven, saw and lusted after them, and said unto one another, come, let us choose us wives from among the children of men. Let us beget children. Samjaja, who was their leader, said unto them, I fear you will not indeed do this deed, and I alone shall have to pay the penalty of the great sin. And they answered and said, let us all swear an oath, and bind ourselves by mutual imprecations, not to abandon this plan, but to do this thing. Then they swear all together and bound themselves by mutual imprecation. And they were in all 200 who descended in the days of Jared on the summit of Mount Hermon. And they called it Mount Hermon because they had sworn and bound themselves by mutual imprecations upon it. Chapter 7. And all the others together with them took to themselves wives, and each chose for himself one. And they began to go in unto them and defile themselves with them. And they taught them charms. Now, because when we get down to why the Messiah is trying to take us away from books and get us solely rely on the Spirit, we're going to understand that, but we got to go through this first. This is so that brothers and sisters can be able to identify with the fact that we have been willingly subjected to demons unknowingly. When you can identify with the fact that you've been up under a demon, then you'll be ready to see. Because the Hamashiach seen this before he ever came. It was one of the key reasons why he came into this world, period. So, let's do this. He said one of the first things they taught the women, it says, and they taught them, it says, they took them wives, each one for themselves, and they began to go into them and defile themselves with them. And they taught them charms and enchantments. Charms and enchantments.
Now, so let's take a look at charms and enchantments. Because sometimes we can figure, we hear a word and we just figure, oh, I know what that means. I know what that means. But you know what? Sometimes you really don't know all that's entailed in that. Because now, charms and enchantments is what was taught at the hands of these fallen ones, which would become demons in the world, who continue to perpetuate and teach the same things. So when we start looking at the things that were taught and then look in the life that we live in, we got to be able to look in the life that we live in, and we got to be able to see these things. So let's see if we can see charms and enchantments. To charm means to seduce, to persuade or fascinate someone or something, whereas enchant means to attract and delight, to charm. So, by way of seven, everybody that thinks charming and enchantment is still operating in this world today, put a seven up in there. Yeah, because it's a whole lot of people. You see what I'm saying? I know when I was in the street, I know I pride myself. I was a charming joker. I was a charming. People tell me all the time, they say, man, I don't know how you got so good with using them words. You know what I mean? But, boy, I learned every slick slang, every hype language. And you talking about charmer. Boy, look, please. My mouthpiece was like the equivalent of the flute to the snake. My mouth was the flute, and the word and what I was charming was gonna be some sister. But them words would be so smooth, and I'm like, you know what? That was me. I know I was charming. I'm charming everything. Before I leave the house, gear is right, hair is right, beard trimmed up, cologne smelling good. All of this. This is my charming. These are my charming accessories. Like when you say, I went from jeans, t-shirts, and tennis shoes to gaiters and suits and beeper hats, my pimping shoes. I cannot lose. You see, this was charming. When you had the conversation and you can do that, hey man, you know what? It just charmed. Oh, it charmed them young sisters so bad when we was coming up. It was just wonderful. Hey, listen, I didn't understand. I didn't know I was operating up under the will of a demon. Because that's where it was learned. That's who taught men how to charm and enchant to attract somebody. You sisters know. You tell me that you ain't enchanting when you in there getting yourself ready. Even I know you're going to the Hebrew gathering. I know you're going to church. But you in there. You're getting all dialed up. You're getting, you smell good. You're looking good. You got your stuff together. And in your mind, you enchanting. Because in the back of your mind, you looking like this so that you can gain the attraction of somebody. You want some man to look at. Hey, baby, don't tell me. Don't tell me that we ain't been subjected up under the wheel of demons in our life on an everyday basis, because we never understood what we was going through. But what we're going to look at is how we got there. Man. The demons taught them how to charm. Because when a woman can charm a man, she can lead him into fornication. And just like Elder Maniel sent me the testament of Reuben some years ago that showed us how women are overtaken more by fornication than men are. But fornication is a pit unto the soul of a man when a woman can lead. But you know what? I'm telling you, a woman can check. And attract the man. It says that the woman used the Egyptian woman. She used love potions on Joseph. She cast spells. She used enchantments. She used charming. She used magic. Trying to get Joseph. He said, and when women
They enchant us with outward wiles of attraction that mean that they dress nice, the cleavage is pushed up, the legs look nice, everything is in order. He said, and they do that so that they can attract the man's attention, because she can't make him just go lie down with her. So she had to attract him in a way to where now he's enchanted by that, and he thinks that it's him that's going to get her. What he don't understand is that she's been operating up under the will of a demon, enchanting you and bringing you into a place of seduction. It said, and those who she can't catch by external means, then she uses other means, other wiles to entrap or ensnare him. Hey, these things operate. You don't think them talk about enchantment and charming. Turn on a video. Look at Cardi B. Look at Megan Stallion. Look at Beyonce. Look at Nicki Minaj. Look at how they have enchanted and charmed and turned a whole generation of girls into whores. Why everybody talking about they is real? Don't tell me that we ain't been up under the wheel of demons. And all of this is to show you why the Messiah came to remove us from these things and bring us into places of the spirit. And they taught them charms and enchantments and the cutting of roots. Who knows what the cutting of roots are? Let's go see. Let's go see. Cuttings of roots. I ain't answering no phone right now. Call you back. Roots. A piece of root used in propagating a plant. As a blackberry, horseradish, oriental poppy. It says, let me go to another one. Let's see if we can find another one with the cutting of roots. It says what? Come on, man, I don't want that. Get that off. It says, what is the cutting of roots? So we're gonna look and see what some of these things mean. Tell you, boy, these euros, boy, they something. Well, let's go. Let's see here. See what we can find here. What is this maximum yield stuff, man? I don't want that. Okay, well, let's look. A root cutting is a portion of plant root that is used for plant propagation. In this method of plant propagation, the portion of the root is cut from a parent plant or called a mother. Okay. Hold on. Propagation. The breeding of specimens of a plant or animal by natural process from the parent stock. The propagation of plants. By cutting of roots, the action of widely spreading and promoting an idea, a theory, a life devoted to the propagation. Okay, so the cutting the roots. Now we look at the cutting the roots. Now I always thought that the cutting the roots might have been dealing with
with, you know, the dealing with plats and the producing of different type of stuff or mixing and matching, or, you know, like they doing now, the cutting the roots with all this weed. You know, it's 1,000 different kinds of weed out here now. So I always dealt with that. And then they mentioned the cutting the roots, dealing with the poppy. Now we know that the poppy is where they get opium from. You know, the cutting the roots, where they get cocaine from. The cutting the roots, the propagation, being able to multiply and fast produce these particular things, or bring them together, or in different type of manners. You understand what I'm saying? Cutting the roots, maybe dealing with being able to deal with plants from the standpoint of producing hallucinogenics or that stuff that they say. What's that stuff that they give you before they put you to sleep, sweetie? What is the anesthesia or something like that? You know, so yeah, all the pharmaceutical and stuff like that, the medication, they taught that. You're going in there getting a prescription pill. You're up under the will of a demon. The cutting of roots. We've been up under many things that we never knew. Because these things were taught by demons, but we didn't know it. But see, the thing is that the Messiah knew it. The Messiah knew it. And the Messiah said, the only way that I can release them from these things, I have to first extract them from books that do not contain any righteousness. And once I lead them to the Spirit, I can expose them to things that they don't know are controlling factors in their life. And when they can see the demon operating, now they can come in the closet and start praying to me about how they're going to overcome. And then the life can be morphed into some righteousness. So we're going somewhere with this. So let's go. It says, and they made them acquainted with herbs. And they became pregnant. And they bore great giants, whose height was 3,000 ells, who consumed all the acquisitions of men. Now, see, when you gonna study the scripture, this is how you have to study it. You can't just graze past words when you don't understand they mean what they mean. He said, and they consume all the acquisitions of men. So what do they mean? All the acquisitions of men. Let's see what acquisitions of men were. Hold on. See, and I can tell you what these are, but I want to look them up because I want people to see it for what it really is. Shouts out. Give me Yahoo, you still over there. I see you over there. I ain't never even got to where I was going yet. Acquisitions, an asset or object bought or obtained. So when we start looking at the acquisitions of men, it says, when they consumed all the acquisitions, and when men could no longer sustain them, the giants turned against them and devoured them. It tells you how tall they were in stature, and it says that they consumed all the acquisitions of men. And when men could no longer sustain them, the giants turned against them and then devoured mankind. And then they began to sin against the birds and the beasts and the reptiles and the fish, and to devour one another's flesh and to drink the blood. Then the earth lay acquisition against the lawless one. So basically is that, okay, the Most High have given men sustenance in order to live in this world. That we know that in the book of Genesis, it said that the Most High said, unto you is given all the fruits of these trees and the seeds, in the which is the seed bearing another tree. These fruits in these earth, they shall be meat for you. So these are acquisitions. These are things that men need for their sustenance. It said now, when they don't consume everything that the Most High had given for mankind, and mankind could no longer sustain them with what God had given them because they consumed it all, it said they turned on the men, then began to eat their flesh and drink their blood. They also turn and begin to defile themselves. Remember, they defiled themselves with women. And we're going to get to this when we go where we go. We're going to show you how they were able to defile themselves. But the same thing they did with the women, they were able to do with the fowls of the air. They were able to do with the fish of the sea. They were able to do with the creeping things and the beasts of the earth. And you're saying, wow, how were they able to do it? Well, we're going to show you. Because there were many things that were taught, and there were many things that these children knew how to do, that their fathers had taught them, their mothers had taught them this knowledge of another dimension. So let's continue. Now, here's where we want to go, because what we're aiming to do is we want to show you in your everyday life that we've been operating up under the will of demons so that we can understand what the Messiah is coming to release us from. And why he would tell us something like that. That is a horrible thing for somebody to tell you. Don't you think that's a horrible thing for somebody to tell you? Man, go take that Bible out there, man. Put it on that barbecue grill. Why don't you go put that Bible on the blazing altar and set it on fire and burn it up? Don't you know that somebody would be ready to stone you to death for that? Because they have fallen in love with a dead thing. And they love the dead thing more than they love the thing that is living, because the spirit is living. As long as I have the spirit, I don't need anything else. But as long as I'm clinging to the dead thing, I'm as the demoniac man in the tombs. And daily in the tombs, he had his dwellings. And daily in the tomb, I got my head stuck in the Torah. In the tombs with dead folks. No man could bind him, not with chains, not with fetters. No matter how much we try to check them and get out of this graveyard, ain't nothing but dead stuff in there. Ain't nothing but dead stuff in there. No, man. He said we put chains on him. We try to put the yoke of the Messiah on him. Try to put the yoke of the Spirit on him. He said no man could bind him. No, not with chains, not with fetters. That often the chains would be plucked asunder and the fetters would be torn apart. He said no man could bind him, but he'd be in the tomb daily crying out and cutting himself with stone. You ain't doing nothing but committing slow suicide of the spirit that the Most High being to be manifesting his righteousness in this world. Committing slow suicide, hanging around dead things, living in a graveyard. Don't want to come out. Living in a graveyard. So let's see if you can see these things. And Uzziel taught men to make swords, knives, shields, breastplates, and made known to them the metals of the earth and the art of working them. Now, are they still making weapons of war? Are they still making weapons of war? Do you know what? Are they still making knives and stuff like that? Almost everybody got knives in their house. You know how those knives got there? You needed those knives so that you can cut up flesh and blood. You needed those knives so that you can cut up the animal. Because you didn't need no knife to eat no orange. You didn't need no knife to eat no apple. You didn't need no knife. You didn't need no knife to eat no nuts. You didn't need no knife to eat no vegetable. Eat no tomato. You didn't need no knife to eat no fruit. He said, but you did need knives when you
when you was eating flesh and blood. You had to cut that flesh and blood up and do something. He said, but the knife also had to be responsible for cutting the throat of the thing that you was going to cut up one day. He said, and if you ever wield the knife, if you was ever wielding a knife for anything, then you've been up under the wheel of demons. This ain't got nothing to do with it. Being no vegan. It's got something to do with whether or not you're going to hear what's being said. Whether you can see these things taking place in your everyday life. And those that might say, I also subscribe to the Book of Enoch, but you got a cabinet full of knives in there. I also subscribe to the Book of Enoch, but you got a pistol in your waistband. I also subscribe to the Book of Enoch, but you can see war on TV all over the world every day. You can see nuclear bombs, tanks, Tomahawk missiles, airplanes. You can see all these things, but you don't subscribe to the Book of Enoch. But these things right here come by way of the demons that taught men how to do these things, because they didn't learn how to do these things on their own.
He made known to them the metals of the earth and the art of working them and the bracelets and the ornaments. Metals of the earth.
You riding around in your car. Almost everything we're dealing with is out of metal. We got furniture in the house. We got cabinets in the house that's made out of metal. All these things wouldn't even exist if they didn't come, if the demons didn't teach men how to do them. And men have been perpetuating and teaching their sons from one generation to the next generation, from eternity to eternity, until now we have been subjected up under the wheel of demons. Some of us know it, some of us don't know it. You got a car outside and it's made of metal. If it wasn't for that demon, you wouldn't have no car to ride in.
You don't subscribe to the book. Yeah, say talk them
how to make bracelets and all that. When your sister's getting dialed up, you're getting dialed up and you got your bracelets on and all that, you don't understand where that came from. You see, the sons, I've been teaching their son from one generation until the next. You see the bracelet in the store. Oh, that's cute. Oh, that's pretty. You buy the bracelet. You put the bracelet on. Oh, that's look nice. You don't understand that the only reason why you got that bracelet up under your arm is because you unknowingly subjected yourself unto the will of a demon. If it wasn't for this demon teaching the sons that, then they wouldn't do it. Look at our brothers out there with their bracelets on, with their metal band bracelets on, talking about that they serving, that they represent Messiah, don't understand themselves that they have been subjected to the will of demons with their swords on their hip. Oh, but they don't subscribe to the Book of Enoch.
He says, and he taught them the use of antimony. Let's see what the use of antimony is. Antimony. The chemical element of atomic number 51, a brittle, silvery, white melatonin. Let's see, more definitions. So the same thing. It's the same thing. Yep. Denoting stibonite, the most common of one of the metals from the medieval Latin antimonium of the unknown origin. The current census dates from the 18th century. It said antimony is a chemical element with the symbol SB and atomic number 51. A lustrous gray melatonin. It is found in nature mainly as the sulfide mineral stibonite. Antimony compounds have been known since ancient times and were powdered for the use as medicine and as cosmetics, often known by the Arabic name koi. So, you see, so they taught them antimony. And the antimony is dealing with these metals, and just like he said, they used to make makeup. Is that what it said? It said medicine and cosmetics. Medicine out of metals in the earth. You know, it take a demon. It take a demon to be able to teach a man that. Men didn't have that type of understanding. So, it, you know, when our sisters understand that, then when they dealing with antimony, they dealing with cosmetics. You know what? See, that's where you get the word hypocrite from. It's not like we use the word. Like we use the word like you a hypocrite. No, that's not how the word is used. It was to hypocrite. It was to hypocrite. To hypocrite means to hide behind the mask. To hide behind the mask. You're dealing with antimony. You're dealing with to a hypocrite. The hypocrite. To hide behind the mask. You're dealing with cosmetics. You're dealing with makeup. You're dealing hiding behind the mask. But when our sisters go and do that and put their face on, they genuinely is just trying to, you know, spice themselves up and look good. And this is the direction that they've been taught, because that's what demons do. Demons seduce us. They seduce us into ways to making us think that these are good things that we're doing. And because we're without knowledge, we don't understand. And then one generation to the next, we are just taught these things and we just see them happening like that, you know. But the sisters don't understand that when you go putting your makeup on and your lipstick on and your eyeshadow and your eyelashes and all that you are hypocriting. You are hiding behind the mask that now you have put on the face of a demon. So your whole attitude changed. Your whole mindset changed. When you put the hair in the flowing Brazilian weave, when you put that in and you put your eyelashes on and you put your face on and you put up, you cease to exist as the person that God made you to. Now you have put on a mask and you have cloaked yourself in a mask. What you don't understand, sister, is that you are up under the will. You have voluntarily submitted yourself to a will of a demon without knowing it. And a lot of times when we bring these things forward, we don't go into detail like we're going into today. So sisters get offended and think we're talking about them, but we're not talking about you. We're simply sure we're talking about all of us. All of us. But in this particular case, this antimony was dealing with cosmetics, because all of these things were taught to the women, and the women taught these things unto the sons, and then they perpetuated from one generation down to the next. Now, do you think that this world and even us have been subjected up under the will of demons? No, I'm just establishing the fact that anybody that try to say the book of Enoch is without merit. Now you let what they saying be without merit. Because all these things we can see operate in our everyday world. And without this particular thing, event to take place in the world, none of these things that we see today will be here like that. So it says, they taught them bracelets and ornaments and the use of antimony and the beautifying of the eyelids. See there? Now, by way of number 7, are women still beautifying their eyelids?
Yes.
You see? Now, here's the thing. When women beautify their eyelids, you know, I'm like my sister, she like her eyelids like that, because, you know, and you know, Solomon used to say, Solomon knew about demons too. One of the instructions that he gave to the young man is that be not taken by their eyelids. Because there was something about the eyelids that was something. And that was even in the book of the Patriots with the Testament of Reuben about the woman. It said that once the eyelids and the glance of the eyes catch you, that's where the poison is instilled. The beautifying of the eyelids. It's something about a woman's eyelids. That's why our sisters like eyelashes. That's why they like the eyeshadow around there. It's something about those eyelids that instills poison in a man. It almost puts a man to a place to where he just become like one that he can't even control himself. That's what it's like. So these things are still happening.
And our sisters are still operating by these things as our men are operating by them. Because you think the average man, he got to have a pistol in his pocket everywhere he go. He don't realize, he think that the gun is for his protection. What he don't understand is that he operating up under the will of a demon. Because if the demon didn't teach him how to make the weapons of the war and teach men the blows of death, he wouldn't have to have no pistol on his hip. And we put pistols on our hip thinking that we protecting each other because we don't know where these things come from. And we're bringing this out so that when we get up here to this place to where we're marching our way on, everybody can already identify. Because when we show you what the Messiah is coming to do, and I'm glad you just showed up, Nazarene Enoch, I'm glad you just showed up because I told you I have something for you. And I know this is probably something that you're not being made, that you might be aware of it. But it's gonna be important. Let's just put it like that. Cause the spirit don't operate according to information. The spirit operates according to what he hears. You see, the spirit is a sheep. And that's why the Messiah said, the spirit, he shall not speak of himself. But whatsoever thing he hear, that shall he speak. You see, the spirit is a sheep of Yeshua HaMashiach, and then we become the sheep of HaMashiach as we listen to the spirit that he sends into the world. It leads us and directs us, but it's going to direct us and lead us away from all of the things that have been written with ink and paper. Now let's go and let's read what else we got. It says, so it talked and taught them beautifying of the eyelids and all kinds of costly stones and all coloring tinctures. See, all coloring the box of crayons. Oh, I know, that's so innocent. Yeah, but you never understood. And you never understood that, you know, what, where it come from, how you learn these things. You see, it's so innocent. It's just a coloring book. It's a coloring book. We learn how every color. Well, diamonds? Look, sweetie pie over there. Sweetie pie over there. Every time I turn around. Baby, you know, you need to get my, you need to go and get my ring. We used to have wedding rings when we got married, you know what I'm saying? But we had some hard times, you know what I mean? I end up pawning my wedding ring and lost it. And she end up pawning hers on hard time and lost that. But the thing is that she always bothered me about, baby, you know, you been saying you're going to get me another wedding ring.
You know what? Here's the thing. I have plenty of rings. I don't need no ring. Because the ring don't mean nothing. It's a lot of people that's married and got a ring and act like they ain't. So I don't necessarily need a ring. I just want one.
I was just saying that because right here, what with these followers, it said, it also taught them all kinds of costly stones and all coloring tincture. And so we have made the wedding ring, and diamonds is a woman's best friend, and diamonds a woman's best, and all that type of stuff. And see, and we don't even understand. When you start making that type of stuff the center of your faction, I remember I was coming up, I have nugget rings on every finger. You don't know where this stuff come from. I'm just simply showing you these things before I get to where I'm at so that you can see that the book of Enoch, everything that's in there is happening right now in our world. So when we start talking about this, let's go on and do the recap and go up in there because I ain't going to keep the video going too long, all right? We tell you what the Messiah said. Now, this is something. Now, Yeshua sat down in their midst and he said, I tell you truly, none can be happy except they do the law. And they answered, we all do the laws of Moses, our lawgiver, even as they are written in the Holy Scripture. And the Messiah said, man, seek not. Don't look for no law in those scripture. The law is life, whereas your scripture is dead. I'm going to tell you the truth. Moses didn't receive no law from God in writing, but through the living word. Don't you understand that the law is living word of a living God to living prophets for living men? Don't you understand that in everything that is life, Is God's law written? He said, man, listen, all things living are closer to God than the scripture, which is without life. God so made life and all living things that they, by the everlasting word, might teach the laws of the true God. So if God made life and all things that live by his everlasting word, that they might teach the true laws of the real God, then guess whose laws we've been up under? Don't tell me we ain't been subjected to the will of no demons when you've been reading all these books and your life still ain't changed. This is what the Messiah came to do. Because the Messiah was aware of every corrupt thing that took place in the world. And he said, you know what? The one thing that I'm coming to do, I'm coming to remove them from all of those books. My spirit gonna lead them to different resources that can point out to them what my lifestyle was like. And when they see my lifestyle, now I'll start instructing them on what to pull back away from. And so this is what he's telling us we need to pull away from. Now, he says, God did not write his laws in the pages of books, but he wrote them in your heart and in your spirit. Listen, because God didn't write his laws in pages of books, Hamashiach said, they up under stem laws that got them bound. Let's go here. Keep your mind right there. God didn't write his laws in pages of books. Keep it right there. Because, man, we got to drive this home. I got to show you. We got to tell you like that boy said. You're going to get this work today. I got to show you. God, remember, God did not write his laws in pages of books. And Moses heard the voice of the Lord thy God and sealed within him the covenant which was between the Lord and the children of light. And Moses turned and went down from the mountain, and the two tablets of stone of the law were in his hand. And the tablets were the work of God and were the writing of God graving upon the tablets. And the people knew not what became of Moses, and they gathered together themselves, and they break off their golden earrings, and they made a molten calf, and they worshiped it unto the idol, and they offered it burnt offerings, and ate and drank and danced before the golden calf. And they danced before the golden calf which they had made, and then they abandoned themselves to the corruption and evil before the Most High. Oh, don't that sound like what they do at these feast days? Don't that sound like what they do when they talking about some Passover and all that mess? Eating, dancing. That's another day. And it came to pass as soon as Moses came near to the camp, that he saw the calf, and he saw the dancing, and he saw the wickedness of the people, and Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tablets out of his hand, and he broke them beneath the mountain. And it came to pass, and on the morrow, that Moses said unto the people, you have sinned a great sin. You have denied thy creator. I will go up unto the Lord and plead atonement for thy sin. And Moses returned unto the Lord, and the Lord said, Moses returned unto the Lord and said, Lord, thou hast seen the desecration of thy holy law, for thy children have lost faith and have worshipped darkness and made for themselves a molten calf. Lord, please forgive them, for they are blind to the light. And the Lord said unto Moses, behold, at the beginning of time was a covenant made between God and man, and the holy flame of the Creator did enter into him, and he was made the son of God, and it was given unto him to guard his inheritance of the firstborn, and to make fruitful the land of his father, and to keep it holy. And he who cast out the Creator from him doth spit on his birthright, and no more grievous sin doth exist in the eyes of the Lord. And the Lord spake unto Moses, only the children of light can keep the commandment of the law. Hear me, for I say thus, the tablets which thou didst break, these shall nevermore be written in the words of men. As thou didst return them to the earth and fire, so shall they live invisible, so shall they live invisible. So shall they live invisible in the hearts of those who are able to follow their law. To thy people of little faith, to thy people of little faith, to thy people of little faith who did sin against thy creator. Even while thou stood on holy ground before thy God, I will give them another law. I will give them another law. I will give them another law. It shall be a stem law. It shall be a stem law. It shall bind them, for they know not yet the kingdom of light. And Moses hid the invisible law within his breast and kept it for a sign for the children of light. And God gave to Moses the written law for the people. And he went down and spake unto the people with a heavy heart. Those tablets that Moses break is because the people refuse to stop killing God's creation and eating them. And because of that, Moses never would have told him to do that. It said Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tablets of stone out of his hand. And when he went back, God said, I'll never, surely as I live, I'll never write these laws of righteousness ever again in the words of men that they can understand. You know why? Because everything that comes after that, he said, would be a stem law. And the stem law would be things that will come by way of ink and paper as a means to bind men up. And when we get there, we can understand what the Messiah was coming to deliver us for. The stem laws were the laws that were written on ink and paper that people had to now govern their lives by. And this is what Yeshua HaMashiach was coming to set us free from. The laws of our forefather that wasn't really God's law. The laws, all of the laws and all the things that people said, God never said it. Now we're going to show you. So let's go here. Because God did not write his laws in pages of books. He didn't write his law in pages of books. Now let's go here. Let me show you why. Nothing wrong with you reading. Nothing wrong with you reading, because reading is a process of growth. I have read so much that this is where I end up at. I don't expect everybody to be where I'm at. But while you're doing what you're doing, you just understand that the process that you're going through is bringing you to the same place of what this video is talking about. You are not supposed to get stuck in one place like many of your brothers doing. I'm Torah. Well, you know what? You can stay over there all you want. Stay stuck out there in the desert with your forefathers. Well, they perished in the desert, never seen the promise. You can stay out there. That's your choice. But we ain't doing that. Those who follow the Messiah will boldly go where no man has gone before. We will star track into places that the Spirit lead us, according to the thing that he will show us dealing with the future. So you can stay over there if you want to. You want to stay right there in your dead church? You go on and stay there. If you think that the church is greater than your closet, if you think the church is greater than your quiet space, your private space, you go on and stay there. You want to stay in that old dead, cursed, corrupted camp situation? You want to stay up under those Hebrew Christian people out there that's still collecting tithes and still church? If you think that those things are greater than consecrated time and quiet time in the closet and communing with the Most High, if you think that that's greater, that's where you stay at. Now, verse 69. It says, verse 5, chapter 69 of verse 5, the book of Enoch. The name of the first angel was Jechon, that is, the one who led astray the sons of God and brought them down to the earth and led them astray through the daughters of men. Now, you remember when we first started reading in the book of Enoch, you got to understand, it talked about 200 descended onto Mount Hermon. But what you understand is that there was another angel called Jechon that led them while they were in another dimension, that got them together and led them from where they were at to where they were. And that was them. Gave them the idea of going into women. And the second was named Ashiel. He imparted unto the holy sons of God
evil counsel and led them astray so that they devour their bodies with the daughters of men. Now remember, we know that the angels defiled themselves with the daughters of men. But now this particular angel right here, this particular angel, Ashia, he had to teach them how to do that. Because angelic beings have angelic bodies, you see. So he taught them how to translate or change their bodies into the bodies of human men in order to have sex with the women. You remember what it said? After they consumed the acquisitions of men and they begin to eat the men and drink their blood, and then they begin to corrupt themselves, they begin to defile themselves with the fowls and with the fish and with the beasts and all. Well, see, he taught them how to transform their bodies in a way to where they can now be sexual with anything. So not only were they sexual with the women, but they were also sexual with the fowls, also sexual with the beasts, also sexual. And people talking about dinosaurs living 100 billion years ago, they can get out of here with that nonsense. We know exactly where it come from, because everything that they defiled themselves with produced a race of abnormal beings, whether it was human or whether it was animal. Now, he said the third name was Gadriel. It is he who showed the children of men the blows of death. You remember? You remember? Aziel taught men how to make the weapons of war. Okay, well, here you got Gadriel. It is he that showed the men, taught men the blows of death. He said he showed the children of men all the blows of death. And he led astray Eve and showed the weapons of death to the sons of men, the shield and the coat of mail and the sword for battle and all of the weapons of death to the children of men. Let me ask you a question. Are men still operating according to the blows of death in this world? Who ain't subscribing to the book of Enoch? Tell me, is brothers still out here killing each other? Is this world not riddled with the blows of death? With the blows of death through weaponry, through knives, through guns, through poisoning, through all of these different things? He taught men the blows of death, how to kill each other. And every time a brother kill another brother, he is operating up under the will of a demon. And people can look at somebody that murder and they can say, oh yeah, he's operating up under the will of a demon. But can you look at your own life and be able to say that to yourself? I've been operating up under the will of a demon, because it's about to get rough in here, baby. And the fourth angel, and the fourth. That's where we're going. We're going to the fourth one. Yep. And the fourth, whose name was Penimul, he taught the children of men the bitter and the sweet. This is where the video caps off at. This is what the whole fight was about. This is why Yeshua HaMashiach declared, how be it when the Spirit come. There are some things you can't comprehend. I have many things to say, but what I got to say ain't never been written with ink and paper. Therefore, you can't comprehend it. How be it when the Spirit of truth come, he shall lead you. He shall guide you. He shall lead you in ways of truth. He shall not speak of himself. He shall only speak that which he heard of me. He can comprehend everything that I say, and he will bring it to you and help you to be able to comprehend it too. This what it was. It was all about. And the fourth name was Penimul, and he taught the children of men the bitter and the sweet, and he taught them all the secrets of earthly wisdom. And he instructed them. That means that the demon gave men instruction. And he instructed mankind in writing with ink and with paper. And thereby many have sinned from eternity to eternity until this day. For men were not created for such a purpose, to give confirmation to their good faith with ink and paper.
For men were created exactly like the angels, to the intent that they should continue pure and righteousness, and death, which destroys everything, could not have taken hold of them. But through this their knowledge, they are perishing, and through this power it is consuming them. He said the fourth name was Pennymule, because Pennymule sent one of the most destructive forces in the world at the hands of the commandment of the Most High. Nevermore shall these commandments ever be written in writing that men can understand. But what they will get in writing will be in writing. It will be a stem law. It will be a law that will bind them. It will be thing that will be an instruction that will come by way at the hand of one wicked demon named Pennymule, who will instruct men in writing with ink and paper. And everything that's been written with ink and paper have controlled the world. It can turn history upside down. Nobody knows the truth about anything. You can read this book, but it won't change your life. Read that book, it won't change your life. In the Bible, you got one thing over here. In the Bible, you got another thing over here. The Bible saying two different completely things on every side, on Paul's side, on Jesus' side, on the Spirit side, on the prophet side, on Adam's side, on Moses' side, on the animal side, on the flesh eating side. On it's saying everything that is different. He said this demon instructed men with the writing of ink and paper, and from eternity unto eternity, men have erred. They have transgressed against the Most High. Because the Most High, good God Almighty, the Most High don't write in pages of books. He put his law in everything that have life. Henceforth did the Messiah come to say, I come to take you away from these things. What part do we find hard to understand? Imagine what it'll be like if every man had his book taken away. That mean that every man has his preeminence taken away. That mean that every man got to go back to being a brother. Every man got to go back to being accountable for his own self. Every man got to go into his own quiet place, into his own closet, into his own space of communion. No longer will another man be responsible for teaching another man, saying, know the Lord. If you didn't have no ink and no paper, ain't nobody. When men get ready to teach something, they teach with ink and paper. But the Most High declared, anybody that's teaching with ink and paper have transgressed from eternity to eternity. Because the Most High don't need anything that's written with ink and paper to confirm our good faith. We don't need no books to be with him. The books are just something that we can partake of. You come full circle. You don't need no book. That's what the whole fight is about. His sheep hear his voice. They will not follow another. What the Messiah say in the Gospel of the Holy 12? Inasmuch as you have done to the least of one of these, my brethren, you have done it to them also. What's the Messiah saying? You can see the Father's righteousness in how we treat each other in creation. I don't need no book to tell me that I'm supposed to love my brother. I don't need no book to tell me that I'm supposed to love my wife, that I'm supposed to take care of my kids. I don't need no book to tell me I'm supposed to work. I don't need no book to tell me I'm supposed to look out for the older people. I don't need no book to tell me all of the things that's down on the inside, just naturally. I don't need no book to tell me none of those things. Only time men want to use books when they got a made up mind that they ain't gonna do nothing that's expected of them, but they're gonna pull out the book every time something come up and they don't want to do something. Every time they want to make an excuse, they got an excuse to make, just like they made in the Messiah's day. Your disciples come and they don't, well, why they don't wash their hands, they don't I said, well, why you don't honor my father? You don't honor my father. You don't honor my father's commandment. You see, you're out there following charlatans when you can get in the closet. You get in the closet. You let the spirit start operating. Because many of you, the Most High ain't gave me nothing that ain't been made available to everybody. Only problem is that we don't all go about it the same way. You get in the closet. You spend as much time by yourself as I spend. I guarantee you the spirit will be doing something great for you. That's why I don't waste my time trying to find friends and trying to be cool with everybody. And see, they ain't doing nothing but take me away from that goodness, that richness that I'm experiencing on a daily basis. When ain't nobody around me, I can be me. I can let my hair down. I can walk around naked. I ain't got to be ashamed. I can look myself in the face and say, Lord, I'm messed up. I still ain't got this right. I ain't got that right. I ain't got to be running around here hypocriting, pretending to be somebody's preacher, pretending to be somebody's pastor. I ain't got to be running around here pretending. Oh, when you want to be in that situation. Oh, when you want to be there. Well, you ain't got to pretend for nobody. When you walk out your door, you can walk out. What you see is what you get. Up, down, in, out, crooked or crazy. Whatever you see me today, it's going to be the same. Tomorrow's going to be the same. You see me on a video. You see me in person. It don't make no difference. Oh, wouldn't you want to be there? Well, you didn't have to pretend. Well, you didn't have to want to be around people that knew they didn't like you. You didn't have to go through none of that superficial nonsense. See, many of our brothers can't be there. You can't come on here and say nothing because you're scared of what people are going to think about you. Oh, wouldn't you want to be in a place where you didn't have to worry about what people think? Go on and think what you want to think. What you think ain't got no bearing on my life. I don't care nothing about what you think. You better be responsible for yourself. You might not like what I'm doing, but you keep on watching the movie, baby. I bet you ain't going to slow this train down, and you ain't going to stop it, and you bet not jump out in front of it. Wouldn't you like to have that freedom? He who the Son set free is free indeed. He don't have to be in no place of pretending. Wouldn't you want to be there? The fourth name was Peniel. I want to see which one of these jokers can come along and tell me that because of the thing that's written with ink and paper, the world ain't been turned upside down. Next video we do, we're going to show you what's written with ink and paper in the Bible. We're going to show you what's written with ink and paper in the Bible that have caused men to err from one generation to the next. Nothing's wrong with every information, but there is a balance that is with it. The information that we glean is so that we can bring ourselves up under the tutelage of the Spirit, and the Spirit can now take what it is that He has guided us to and then dissect it up amongst our brothers and our sisters. From eternity to eternity until this day, through their knowledge, men are perishing. We are more concerned about our knowledge. Our knowledge is just dealing with the historical things and the historical events of man on the earth. Through our knowledge, we're perishing because we're literally consumed by it. But when we start focusing on the Most High's knowledge, that's something totally different. Let me show you something before I end this video. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 11. Let me show you something before I end this video. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 11. Because I'm going to show you the difference between our knowledge, which comes by way of ink and paper that was instructing us how we supposed to operate in this world. But we operate up under demons, and the world had never changed. But let me show you what God's knowledge is going to produce in the world so you can see the difference. When you see what God's knowledge is going to produce, you can understand why the Messiah had to send the Spirit into the world. Now listen at what the prophet is saying about the Messiah. Listen at this. And there shall come forth, 11th chapter, a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of it. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. You see that? And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. It didn't say nothing about the writing, the Torah, shall rest upon him. The law of Moses shall rest upon him. It didn't say the prophets was going to rest. It said the spirit of the Lord was going to rest upon him. And the spirit of wisdom. It didn't say nothing about no Torah. Because see, when he got here, all that stuff already existed. And if that is where our righteousness was going to come from, then guess what? It would be no need for him to come. So when he did come, he bypassed all of that stuff that had preceded him. It said the spirit of the Lord would rest upon him, and the spirit of wisdom, and the spirit of understanding, and the spirit of counsel, and the spirit of might, and the spirit of knowledge, and of the fear of the Most High. Don't tell me nothing when you start talking about that the Spirit will lead and guide you into ways of all truth. Look at how much stuff comes with us walking in the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of understanding, the Spirit of counsel, the Spirit of might. When I start walking in the footsteps of the Spirit, you ain't gonna tell me that you can get some counsel, because I got the Spirit of counsel, got the Spirit of wisdom, got the Spirit to be able to understand anything that my brother or my sister are dealing with, got the Spirit of the Lord that I ain't got to be afraid or fearful of nobody, ain't got to be afraid of no question, no matter where I come from. He who God sent speaketh the words of God. God give not the Spirit to that man by measure. This is what he done for the Messiah. All of that other stuff that these brothers is holding on to, you let them hold on to it. And the day you hear the Most High's voice, you harden not your heart. So let's look. Let's see. It says, and he shall make him of a quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked, and the righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins. And the wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and the little child shall lead them, and the cow and the bear shall feed. Their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox, and the suckling child shall play on the hole of the apse, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the cockatrice den, for they shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord, even as the waters cover the sea. You see the difference? You see the difference? You see, because the followers taught men all the secrets of men's knowledge and wisdom. And he instructed them how to write things with ink and paper. And by the things that been written with ink and paper, we have continuously tried to live our lives off of those things. But the Messiah said, when the spirit of wisdom comes, when the spirit of counsel comes, when the spirit of the Lord, when the spirit of might comes, he said, we shall move in this earth. He said, now, when the whole earth is full of God's knowledge, then you'll see the world get turned upside right. He said, no longer will a lamb be chasing down a gazelle. He said, the wolf shall lie down with the lamb. The kid and the leopard going to play together. He said, the bear, all of the animals going to have cohesiveness. Why? He said, because the whole earth will be full of the knowledge of the Most High. And if this is the result of what the world going to be like, when the knowledge of the Most High is covering the earth like the waters covered, if that is what it's going to be like, well, what can you say about now? We see what the result of the earth going to be like when God's knowledge is in the earth. Let's look at our world right now. Because we seem to think that we got God's knowledge. You seem to think you got God's knowledge. What you don't understand is that you've been following in the footsteps of one penny mule who gave you the instruction to take your cues by things that were written with ink and paper. And the Most High allowed them to do it because of old wicked Aaron making the calf at the base of the mountain. You'll never again understand God's righteous laws of life in words that men could understand, because God wrote not his laws in writing with Moses, and God wrote not in pages of books, but God writes in everything that he have given life. And when the earth is full of God's knowledge, it won't be what it is now. Everybody fighting, everybody confused. Israel, Israel, Israel. Everybody taking their cues off of ink and paper. First thing you get up is, Five hours you've sacrificed your life in this world. In 5 hours, do you have any idea how you could have impacted this world that you was living in? 5 hours, 7 hours, 20 hours a week, 40 hours a week. Don't you understand them are hours that you are missing living in this world? Seeing God's goodness, walking in God's righteousness? The next video we do, right out the gate, we're going to be on penny mule. So, I'll praise to the Most High Heavenly Father's glory, Son. I hope y'all got something out of this video.